Good morning. Welcome to worship at Calvary Presbyterian Church. We are so glad each and every one of you are here or visiting us online. Welcome. Couple of announcements. First of all, next Sunday there will be no Know Your Theological Grid Bible study because Pastor Dan and Deb are going to be out of town all week. So remember that. We have it today, but not next. Today, of course, there is coffee hour, followed by that grid class. One additional announcement that I'm going to make, on August 7th, mark that on your calendar, there's a sign-up sheet out in the Bigler lobby, and there's going to be a new member celebration meal. The meal's going to be Salisbury steak, and we're going to be celebrating five individuals that have decided to join us as Covenant Partners: Bill and Cindy Heinzman, and Button Smith, and Dave and Lorraine Swiger. So we're so pleased to see growth in our church family. So check out that sign-up sheet, and we'd love to see you there. That's all the announcements I have, but Barb Hildebrandt has something she wants to talk to you about.
Good morning. We're excited to announce that on Wednesday, July 27th, we're going to have a one-night VBS here at Calvary, and the theme is God, Kids, and Love, so it's going to be about how God loves us and how we love God, and it's for kindergarten through sixth grade. Brian Van Zeus will be playing Jesus, and he's pretty excited about that. No pressure, Brian, right? What do we need from you? We need two or three food helpers. We need some older kids, if you have older kids in your family who would like to help out with crafts and games. We would love to have them. We also need anybody that you know, whether it's your children, whether it's your neighbors, your nieces and nephews, your grandkids, anybody you know, just feel free to fill out one of these forms. They're at both of the entrances, and just get it back to us before July 27th. And we also cover your prayers for that. So any other questions, just see Joe or Terry or myself. Thanks.
Great. Thank you, Barb. That sounds like a wonderful opportunity to serve the children. So now if we'll switch gears a little bit, let's just quiet our hearts and minds and have a moment of silence as we head into worship. Let us pray. Father God, we love you and we are thankful for this group of believers assembled here and those joining us online as we worship you here today. You are so good to us, and yet we often take your blessings for granted. Let us always remember to properly put you first in every aspect of our lives, just as Jesus did. Let us put you first in everything because you are the author of all life, and the only one with all the answers. You are powerful. You are all-knowing. You are all-seeing. You are omnipresent. And yet, you made us in your image for the purpose to glorify you and enjoy you forever. Help us to give you right praise and worship, just as you deserve. Today, we raise your name above all other names and acknowledge that only you are good. We are sinners in need of a Savior. And as the scripture says, while we were still sinners, you gave us your Son, which is amazing enough, but especially when we realize why Jesus came to earth, for the purpose of paying a debt we could never repay ourselves by dying for our sins on the cross. Please help us to accept that greatest gift ever given and to fulfill the great commission of the church as individuals and members of this church body. Lord, we thank you for Pastor Dan and Deb and all the staff and leaders of this congregation. Protect our church, and especially those in authority, from attacks of the evil one, who is probably not happy with what he sees going on here at Calvary, as our servant shepherd leads us to grow deeper in faith in a multitude of ways, as we've seen. In our local mission field, Help us to be Jesus' hands and feet for the community around us. We thank you for the specific ministries we've been called to, including loaves and fishes, mobile food pantries, this senior gift bag project with Emmaus, opportunities to mentor women at the Cass County Jail, just to name a few. Bless these ministries, Lord. Help us to be alert for new opportunities to spread your gospel in places both near and far as we live out our lives in community together. We lift up our friends and family members who cry out for relief. A rock-solid relationship with you, including prayer, worship, Bible reading, memorization, and studying Scripture, and Christian fellowship is always important. We know many people who suffer chronic or acute pain or diminished mobility from accidents, falls, medical conditions, or even just aging. Many also suffer from major or minor medical conditions, including cancer, heart disease, lung issues. Heal them, Lord. Additionally, we lift up those who are struggling in marriage or relationships. Bring healing and grace and peace to all those afflicted through the saving power of our Lord and Savior Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, Dave.
Good morning. Pastor Dan is going to be preaching today on Heart of Worship. And that is actually it's our second song. It's an older song, but boy, it's a goodie. But the first song we're singing is called My Jesus. And there's the phrase in there that says, let me tell you about my Jesus. And each one of us has to take ownership of my Jesus. We can't set back on, I grew up in a Christian church or a Christian family, or my folks were Christians, or my spouse or anybody else. It's got to be me. I can't talk about Pastor Dan's Jesus or Jim Peterson's Jesus or Nikki Reed's Jesus. You have to take ownership of it. It's got to be personal. I hope that's where you're at. And I hope that's how you worship today. I hope that when you sing, and when you listen, and when you praise, that it is about my Jesus. It's not somebody else's. Because if it's about somebody else's, you got a problem. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. That's the Jesus you need to grab a hold of. And it has to be a personal thing. Let's stand and sing.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? Cause the shame does all it's stealing. And you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. Good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah, 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 amen, amen. Peter. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Wrong turns that you would go and undo if you could. Work it all for good. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. Good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. 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 Take the cross to Calvary. Pay the price for all my guilty. Who told that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. I know the news, I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Let my Jesus change your life.
When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one can express how much you deserve. Though we can pour, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. Yeah. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
All about you.
Lord, help us to make it about you. Open our eyes and our hearts and our ears to receive the message today of what you have for us. Lord, let this be a time of worship, not just a time of being here. Let us pour our heart and soul into it, Father. Accept our praise.
I'll bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song.
Kids, you are dismissed, and Brother Brian will hick you down. I was a worship pastor for a number of years, and I'm always interested in backstories because sometimes they make the song just that much more important. The song, Let Me Tell You About My Jesus, if you don't know the backstory of that, she wrote that after her brother died. It's a young 20-year-old young man. And she is singing about, let me tell you about my Jesus, because she found hope in that. And then Matt Redman's song, a very old song, but it's probably one of my favorites. Matt Redman was a worship pastor in England, and his pastor began observing that the church was just singing. They weren't worshiping. And so one day in a staff meeting, he said to Matt, I'm done with singing. Matt went, what are you talking about? He said, no more songs in church. We're just going to come and I'm going to preach the word. We're not going to sing anymore. Not until the people realize that singing is not about singing, it's about worshiping. And guess what song came out of that? Matt Redman's song, I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing that I've made it, because it's not about me singing, it's all about church. It's all about you. It's all about you. What a powerful message that is. So I hope that helps you to sing a little differently, especially those two wonderful songs. Deb, if you'll move me forward, please. Thanks. Proverbs 15, 8 and 9, if you'll read with me, please. The Lord detests the sacrifice of the wicked, but the prayer of the upright pleases him. The Lord detests the way of the wicked, but he loves those who pursue righteousness. Wonderful. Father, continue to bless us, Lord. Help us to move into that place where sincere worship is coming out of us. Lord, I know that we gather sometimes, and sometimes we just sing, and sometimes we listen to a good lecture, and it never moves to that place where we really need to encounter you. We never come to the place where we worship you in this space. And a lot of that has to do with just how we got out of bed in the morning. It has nothing to do with the worship leader and the songs that he chose. It has nothing to do with the pastor and how he preached, whether it was good or bad, whether the message was of substance or not. Sometimes it doesn't matter what we lay before someone, if the heart isn't ready to receive it, then it'll just be a song or a sermon. And that's not what we're here for, Lord. We're here to praise and worship and adore and to ask for an encounter with you, Lord. That's what we're praying for. So help us with that as we move into the Word of God, as we continue to worship you, moving from song to to word. We ask it in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, please. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you, church. Genesis is, as its name suggests, a book of beginnings. It's the beginning of creation, it's the beginning of man, it's the beginning of sin. It's the beginning of redemption, the beginning of divine covenants, and it's the beginning of faith as a necessary ingredient to being right with God. Most believe that this came with the person of Abraham, of whom Genesis says he believed God, church, you know that, and it was credited to him as righteousness. But that would be incorrect, because Abraham was simply in a long line of other men and women who came before him that preceded him in this wonderful thing called faith. The passage that we will be looking at this morning is known as the first fratricide, the first fratricide, or the first killing of a brother by his own brother. But let us not be deceived. You see, the story has always been about true faith and the reaction to it. It's why it's listed in the Hall of Faith in Hebrews 11. So I'm going to ask, if you would, please, if you have your Bible app, or if neither, it'll always be up on the screen. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 4. The verse is divided into three parts, and if you'll say the emphasized parts with me as we move through, please. So this is one verse. I just brought it out in good pastoral form so that you can see the major points. So let's begin. Read the yellow with me if you would. By faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, Abel still speaks even though he is dead. Now, before we examine these three points, I want to go back to the full story found in Genesis chapter 4, verses 11 through 10. And I'm going to be reading a little different translation, because I like how the Hebrews translate a little bit better. It's the New Living Translation. It translates the Hebrew into the English a little bit cleaner, all right? So if you'll just follow along with me, please, we're going to be reading verses 1 to 10 in chapter 4 of Genesis from the New Living Translation. Now Adam had sexual relations with his wife Eve, and she became pregnant. And when she gave birth to Cain, she said, "With the Lord's help, I have produced a man." And later she gave birth to his brother and named him Abel. And when they grew up, Abel became what, church? He became a shepherd, while Cain cultivated the ground. And when it was time for the harvest, or the end of the season, or the end of the age, it's difficult to translate that. For when it came time for the harvest, Cain presented some of his crops as a gift to the Lord. Abel also brought a gift, the best of the firstborn lambs from his flock. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not do what, church? He did not accept Cain and his gift, and this made Cain very angry, and he looked dejected. "Why are you so angry?" the Lord asked Cain. "Why do you look so dejected? You will be accepted if you do what is right. But if you refuse to do what is right, then watch out. Sin is crouching at the door, eager to control you, but you must subdue it and be its master." One day, Cain suggested to his brother, "Hey, let's go out into the fields." And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel. And he did what, church? And he killed him. And afterward, the Lord asked Cain, "Where is your brother? Where is Abel?" By the way, this isn't because God doesn't know. This is called, I want a confession. I want you to go towards repentance, all right? Afterward, the Lord asked Cain, "Where is your brother? Where is Abel?" And Cain said, "I don't know. Am I my brothers in the old King James. I still like that one. Am I my brother's keeper? Am I my brother's keeper? But the Lord said, what have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Amazing passage of scripture from Genesis chapter 4, verses 1 through 10. There were three aspects of Abel's faith that the writer to the Hebrews picks up by example. I want us to look at the first, if you would, please. It's this: by faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. The writer, under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, says that Abel's offering was a better offering than Cain's. And the natural question that we have to ask is, why? Why was Abel's sacrifice a better sacrifice than Cain's? Well, the Hebrew scholars say that the word mincha, it's the word for offering, is simply a reverential free will offering and does not entail anything specific. In other words, the better cannot be one of content. So in the Hebrew, it doesn't say that a lamb is better than grain. Does that make sense, church? So we want to rush to that because we know the rest of the Bible and we know the New Testament and we know that Jesus was called the Lamb of God, you know, given that perfect sacrifice for sin. We all know that. We want to rush ahead to that. And so we automatically rush to judgment on that passage of Scripture, and we can't. Because the sacrifices were equally available for anyone to offer God. In fact, if you go to Leviticus and you look through the offering system, lamb offerings were offered in certain circumstances, but so were what, church? Grain offerings, or what we call cereal offerings. They were perfectly acceptable to God. In fact, God commanded that those things be made. So the question yet remains, then why? Why was one accepted and why was one not? And I would agree that there's a distinction being made in the acceptability, but it doesn't consider the larger context of the story. Better relates to that word doing. When you go back into Genesis 4, it's God said to Cain, will you not be accepted if you do what is right? He said that twice, by the way. Will you not be accepted? Will your sacrifice not be accepted? By the way, I don't know if you caught this or not. God didn't say your sacrifice would be accepted. He said, you will be accepted. The sacrifice is an extension of the person. Are you getting that? That's important because it's helping us to understand what is not only going on in Genesis 4, it's also helping us to understand Hebrews 11. And 4 as well. It's not about the sacrifice, you see. There's something different going on. But I want to elaborate a little bit. The better does relate to doing, and the doing is related to what is right. So if we go back into the last the chapter of chapter 3, we'll see God sacrificing an animal to cover the nakedness of Adam and Eve. It's the first time a sacrifice is mentioned in the Bible. And it's a blood sacrifice for the purpose of covering, which is another word, by the way, for atoning. Covering is an atoning. The Ark of the Covenant had a top on it called it's the atonement covering. It's that which covers. Where was the blood poured out on? The atonement, on the covering, on the top of the lid of the Ark of the Covenant. All those things are relating to this as we look at this. So I don't think that it's a stretch to think that this type of sacrifice was imitated by Adam and Eve or even commanded by God as a way of remembrance. We're not told why these two brothers brought anything. There's an assumption in those first four verses, and we don't know why, all right? But it also misses the point of Hebrews. it was a better sacrifice, not because of the content, but because of the faith that accompanied it. By faith, Abel brought a better sacrifice to God. By faith, Abel did something that was better than his brother because he believed something that his brother did not believe. He believed something about God. He believed something about the promises of hope from God. Because if we go back into Hebrews, it's the first example that comes out of verses 1 and 2. Faith is confidence in what we hope for. It's the assurance of what is not seen. Faith is the tangible substance of that which is hoped for, the evidence of something invisible or unseen. Abel was grabbing a hold of something that was observable to his brother, and it led him to offer a better sacrifice to God. So I would argue, church, that in some way, yes, the lamb was important, because I think it has to do with the sacrifice needed to be offered. But the larger question is the faith issue. Because Abel could have offered the first fruits of the lamb without faith, it still would have been unaccepted, and all God's people said. It would have still been an unacceptable sacrifice. It has to be mixed with faith. Cain offered a sacrifice, but it was not mixed with faith. And when a sacrifice is not mixed with faith, it is at best an empty religious exercise, and at worst, it's a sinful form of pride or manipulation to get God to do what you want him to do. If it comes from someone who is evil in heart, as we read in Proverbs at the beginning of our time, it says that the Lord detests that type of sacrifice. It's the height of hypocrisy. Church, once again, when a sacrifice is not mixed with faith, it is at best an empty religious exercise, and at worst, a sinful form of pride and manipulation. And my question always is to those in the church, which one are you bringing? Perhaps Cain was simply tired of getting a sheep from his brother and decided that the work of his own hands was just as good, just as effective. So why do I have to do it God's way? Why can't I decide what works for me? Why can't I decide what I have time for or what the cost should be to me? Why can't I determine the way that I want to come to God? I mean, I'm bringing something, right? I showed up to church today, right? I'm doing something. Well, the answer to that is apparently not. For God did not accept his offering. God said to Cain, "Will you not be accepted if you do what is right?" Do what is right, Cain. Or sin will control you instead of you controlling sin. I want to read a New Testament passage to you. This is 1 John 3:12. I'll be alluding to this a bit later, so if you'll pay attention, please. 1 John 3:12 says, "Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one, and he murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil, and his brothers were righteous." Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil, and his brothers were righteous. Cain did not have a heart of worship. He was going through all of the ritual motions, but there was no connection. Isaiah says, "My people worship, they praise me with their lips, but what is so far away from God?" The heart is so far away. They're going through the motions. They're singing all the songs. They're saying the Lord's Prayer because they've got it all memorized. They've done everything that churchy people do, religiously devoted people do. Everything's coming out the way it's supposed to be expected. But guess what is so far away from me today? The heart. This leads to the second aspect of faith, which is found in Hebrews 11 and verse 4. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings. God looked at Abel's offerings and said, now here's a man whose faith is in the right place and in the right person, and I'm going to acknowledge that by accepting it. Remember the words he spoke to Cain. If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? It's not about the sacrifice. It's about the sacrifice being representational of the one who's sacrificing. It's about the giver. It's about the one who comes with faith or without faith. Abel was declared righteous, not simply because of what was given, but because of the faith that prompted him to give what was right. Once again, he was declared righteous, not simply because of what was given, but because of the faith that prompted him to give what was right. You see, because God is after the heart, and he looks at the faith, and the result is found in our third point together, if you would, please. And by faith, Abel still speaks, even though he's dead. Isn't that an amazing passage of Scripture? Abel had the type of faith that was commended by God, and here's the other point, it was despised by his brother. Oh, this isn't a valid point for us today, church. Abel had the type of faith that was commended by God, but despised by his brother. Listen again to that following verse that I quoted in 1 John 3. I'm going to add the 13th verse to it, though. Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil and his brother's were righteous. Verse 13, so do not be surprised, my brothers and sisters, if the world hates you. Abel still speaks. Abel's life of faith is still a vibrant witness. Abel represented not only everything that Cain wasn't, everything that a righteous follower of Christ, follower of God is. Abel represented not only everything that that type of person is, but he also represented everything that Cain wasn't, everything that Cain didn't want, everything Cain hated to the extent that he killed his brother over it. Cain killed Abel because he hated what he represented. Every time he saw his brother, he saw his own willful sin. He saw a righteous man given, or righteousness given to him by his Creator that manifests itself in doing that which was right. And how do you get rid of that constant temptation? How do you get rid of that constant affliction of a reminder of, yes, I'm falling short of God and I hate that. How do you get rid of it? In Cain's case, you do what? You get rid of the mirror. You kill your brother. I don't know if we realize that, church, of how powerful your witness and your testimony is out in the world when you live a life that is a sold-out follower of Jesus. You are going to represent everything that God desires in humanity. You're going to represent what it means to be a follower of Christ, a sinner set free by the blood of Christ. Yes, he's not perfect. No, she's not perfect, but they're working it out. And as you work it out to those who do not love God, to those who want nothing to do with God, you are a visible reminder and a visible witness of what they not only are not, but what they hate. And we don't often think about that, and we need to. I'm watching this play out. I don't know how many times lately I've sat down at the dinner table with Deb, and I just shake my head, and I just think, how can things get much worse? How can this great divide between that which is righteous and godly morality in every aspect, how can there get much more of a divide? I see a chasm, and perhaps it's been in other generations as well, perhaps it's just in ours, but the vitriol, just the hateful speech and language that's coming out that are against the things that God loves, to me, I'm just paying attention to that. And I can't help but think, maybe I've just been saturated with Genesis chapter 4 and Hebrews 11, 4 this week, but I think often about if I'm going to pursue Christ with my life, if I'm going to pursue a life like Abel, to have that type of faith, I know that God is going to accept me and the sacrifice that I give, and I'll talk to you about what that is because we don't do that anymore. But I also have to be reminded that in my quest to serve and follow Christ, there are going to be some people that really hate me for that. Because I remind them of everything that God has called them to be that they are refusing to follow and to do in their life. And so the pushback is going to be there verbally, in actions. It's going to be in front of me all the time. And I have to figure out how to navigate that as a follower of Jesus as well. I was in a meeting this morning, and I was just reminded of an ancient prayer. It was called A Prayer for My Enemies. And in the middle of that prayer, I've just been using this catchphrase a lot because it's been helpful for me. In the prayer, it says, God, help me to realize that I truly don't have any enemies. I just have people who need Jesus. Father, help me to realize that I don't have true enemies. I just have cruel friends. Is that not an interesting statement? I just have cruel friends. And the psalmist, the one who is writing this poem, this song, goes on to elaborate, and he says, do not our enemies force us into the very presence of God to get us on our knees even more? And I thought, oh my goodness, that is so true. That my enemies, in some sense, are my greatest blessings because they drive me into the presence of God. They drive me into the scriptures to find answers. They drive me into a deeper prayer life because I have no other place to go. My enemies are simply cruel friends. And what a truth that is. And so when I look at this last point, and by faith Abel still speaks, even though he is dead, I'm reminded of that my witness and how I live my life has sort of an exponential property to it, that long after I'm gone, Lord willing, my witness will keep resonating out into my world and especially to those who know me. But didn't Cain bring an offering as well, church? And the answer is, yes, he did. But Cain's motivation for an offering was resentful, ritual, obligation. It was not worship, and that is why God detested it. Faith. Will Jesus find it when he comes? Will he find that type of faith that Abel had in you and me? I have 5 questions for you this morning. Usually I try to give you statements, but I want to just offer you some things to think about today. The first one is this. When Jesus comes, because that's our Luke 18 springboard, when Jesus comes the second time, will he find faith? So I'm asking that about myself today. When Jesus comes, Dan, answer this question for me if you would. When Jesus comes, will he find a faith that leads to an acceptable what? Here's my sacrifice. It's a living sacrifice. That's me. It's my life. Jesus has paid the ultimate price for me. Now what does God require of me? He requires to have an open life so that Christ can live in and through me, to sacrifice my desires, my hopes, my dreams, so that Christ can live all of his desires and his plans out in my life. And so when Christ comes back, will he find a man who has such faith that he is offering an acceptable sacrifice to God, which is his life? For Christ, Or is he going to find an unacceptable faith that is based on a resentful ritual, keyword church, obligation, an obligatory system that it's inwardly shunned and rejected? In other words, and we all know this because a lot of times it happens with children. Children are raised in church, but every Sunday morning they're sitting there like what? This is the last place I want to be, and I can't wait to get older, because when I do, guess what I'm not doing? I'm not going to church. I didn't find any value. I would much rather sleep in on Sunday mornings and do what I want to do, and I don't want to be here. But we look out, and they're all there. They're smiling, and they're with mom and dad. By the way, thank you, mom and dads, for dragging your children to church. They're all there. But they're there with what? As a living sacrifice or as dutiful, obligatory individuals who are only there because they have to? Wow. Brother Steve and I remember this from our Bible study, what that gentleman said. You know, I brought my kids to church. I introduced them to church, but I forgot to introduce them to Jesus. I introduced them to a religious system, but I forgot to introduce them to the Savior of their life. Wow. And that's not meant to guilt you or to shame you. It's just meant to personally bring it home to me. Why do I go to church? Why do I read my Bible? I don't know about you, but sometimes I get up in the morning and I open my Bible and I don't feel like it. And all God's people said, I don't feel like it. And I am duty bound. I know that I'm supposed to be in the Word of God today. God forgive me if I have a spirit like that. And it's usually how I start, by the way. Lord, you know I'm here and I don't want to be. So you're going to have to figure this out. But I'm going to stay faithful, and I'm going to ask your Holy Spirit to work a heart in that I need to have right now, because I just don't want to be here, Lord. And sometimes the Lord says, well, just close the darn thing up and go about your way. It's all right. Don't worry about it. I'll catch you later on. And sometimes that happens. Sometimes in the middle of the afternoon, I'm in a right place to meet the Lord. Sometimes it's right before I go to bed. There's nothing magic about doing devotions first thing in the morning. And all God's people said, please. It's nice. David rose early in the morning and he met with the Lord. And I think it's a great way to start your day. Get your instructions first. Sometimes you wake up and it's just not there, church. So don't beat yourself up about that. What you need to beat yourself up about is every time you get into the scriptures, the only reason you're doing it is because you're obliged to. As Dave, Brother Dave said, I think you got a problem. If you're grabbing a hold of somebody else's Jesus and you don't have it for yourself, there's an issue there. When Jesus comes, will he find a faith that leads to an acceptable living sacrifice for him? And I just want to say, Lord, it's here. It's my faith. Help me with that, because I sure don't want that second part. And all God's people said, please. I don't want a ritualistic, obligatory faith. That God detests that. I can take you to at least three places in the Old Testament where God said, I wish you would just close the door of the temple and be done. I don't want your sacrifices anymore. I don't want any of that stuff. Can you just close the church? Because what you're bringing is detestable to me. Wow. Can you imagine God saying that? Don't come into this place, because what you're offering me is not what I want. It's sort of like the English pastor who said to Matt Redman, I'm done with singing. We're not doing it anymore. We're not worshiping God. We're just singing songs. Let's not do that. Second one, if you would please, Deb. Next question for Dan Lute today. When Jesus comes, will he find a faith that is declared what? Righteous. Not because of anything that I have done, but because of the righteousness of Jesus that we have embraced. Dan, have you embraced Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? By faith, have you received that? And by faith, have you received his righteousness in place of your sin? And I get to stand before you and say, amen and amen and amen. How do you answer that question today? Can you stand before God and hear the Lord say, I declare you righteous, not because of anything that you have done, but because of what Christ has done. And now the work that you must do is to receive his finished work on the cross. That's the difference between the Old and the New Testament. Is he declaring you righteous because of the blood of Christ this morning? I hope you can say amen to that. Next, please, Deb. Dan, will Jesus find in you a faith that the world hates? And will you ultimately be persecuted for that faith? Is that the type of faith you have? Is anybody challenged by how you live your life out in your world? Does anybody look at you and go, A, boy, I wish I had what he had. I don't know what it is, but boy, I wish I had that. Boy, that's a great witness. Part B, is anybody going, I don't want anything to do with that guy. All he talks about is Jesus. All he talks about is the Bible. All he talks about is how wonderful God is and how much he loves him. I can't stand to be around that guy. Do you want that witness? And all God's people said, hallelujah, man, I want that witness too. I want people to say, I want what he has, but I also want the witness of the ungodly, unbelieving, wicked person who says, you know what, every time I'm with that guy, I feel guilty. I don't know what it is. He doesn't say anything to me. Every time I'm with him, whatever, however he's living his life, whatever comes out of his mouth, I don't know what it is, but it just grates at me. I don't know what it is, but I just can't stand being in his presence. Dan, do you have that type of faith? Boy, Lord, I hope so. I hope I have that type of faith. I have a type of faith that is so attractive to people who are looking for an answer that they can see Jesus in me. I hope that, Lord, I have that type of faith. I hope that I have that able type of faith. And I hope I have the type of faith that repulses other people. Paul says this, you know, Jesus for a believer is a fragrance of life, but for people who are wicked and evil, it's the fragrance of what? Death. It stinks. You stink to people who don't love God. Amen for that. That's how it's supposed to be. Next step, if you would, please. Dan, will Jesus find in you a faith that does what? This is a legacy verse, church. Will Jesus find in me, Dan, a faith that speaks long after my death about the goodness and grace of God? I want people long after I'm gone to say, boy, do you remember old Pastor Dan? Of course, all of you are going to be dead too, so. Cole and Hope, you're our only hope. You're going to outlive us. I want you guys to say, hey, do you remember old Pastor Dan? Boy, he loved the Lord, didn't he? Boy, he sure did love the scriptures. Boy, he wasn't afraid to tell us what we needed. Oh, goodness sakes. Boy, Dan, you remember old Dan Lute? He was our neighbor across the street. You remember him and Deb? Boy, they were such good people, weren't they? They loved the Lord. Oh, goodness sakes. You remember them? Do you have that type of faith, church? Do you have that legacy where your kids and your grandkids and your neighbors and people you work with, do you have the type of faith where if something should happen and the Lord should take you home, that they're going to show up at your funeral and say, boy, you know, they were good folk. Boy, they loved the Lord. Will Jesus find in me that type of able faith that speaks long after my death? Next step, please. Will he find in me a faith that does what, church? That points to a better sacrifice than Abel's, to Jesus himself. You see, that's the difference between Abel's, and I want to give you a clarity here. Abel's blood cried out to the Lord for what? For vengeance. It's those souls under the altar in Revelation 6 that cried out to God, how long, O Lord, before you take vengeance on those who martyred us? How long, O Lord? Abel's blood cries out for vengeance, but Jesus' blood doesn't cry out for vengeance. Jesus' blood cries out for what? Forgiveness. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. Jesus' blood cries out for mercy and for grace. Will people find that type of faith in me? A greater than able faith that keeps pointing people to Jesus, that doesn't cry out, vengeance, vengeance, but cries out, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Do you have the faith of Abel today, church? Think through that as we close together. Would you stand with me, please? We're going to be singing another wonderful hymn, 410, if you need your hymn book this morning. Faith, my faith looks up to thee. 410, my faith looks up to thee. Oh Lord, we just so thank you for small passages. We had one verse today, Lord, and how impactful it is to think through that. And I know my personal prayer today, as I work through that this week, I want an able type of faith. That's what I want, Lord. I have a lot of it, Lord. Some of it's already been taken care of because of my faith in you, but some of it's still out in front of me. That legacy part, Lord, of living my life in such a way that I point people to Christ, that I leave something later on after I leave this world, Lord. Those are things that are out in front of me that I'm still pursuing. Faith is that substance of things hoped for, and that is what I'm hoping for, Lord. I'm hoping for a type of faith that does those things, and I pray that for our people today. Bless us, Lord, as we apply your word, as we think about these wonderful things today, and as we leave, Lord willing, with worship on our hearts as we sing this last hymn of faith. We ask it in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, please, faith looks up to thee. My faith looks up to thee, church.
My faith looks up to thee, thou Lamb of Calvary, Savior divine. Now hear me while I pray, take all my guilt away. Oh, let me from this day be whole. Grace impart strength to my fainting heart, my zeal inspire. As thou hast died for me, oh, may my love to thee pure, warm, and changeless be, a living fire. Dark maze I tread, and griefs around me spread. Be thou my guide. Bid darkness turn to day. Wipe sorrow's tears away. Nor let me ever stray from thee aside. When ends life's passing dream, when death's cold threatening stream shall o'er me roll, blessed Savior, then in love fear and distrust remove. All life me safe above and ransom soul.
Father, thanks for a good day in your house. Thanks for good songs sung. Thanks for attentive people to your word. Thank you, Father. We don't often mention this, but thank you for those who give. give of their tithes and offerings so that we can actually come into this place. It is our act of worship as well, Lord, but it's that hidden part, Lord, that is between you and I. And so we thank you for those things. Thank you for just a good morning of worship. And we just pray that your people would be encouraged. I pray that they'll take those questions seriously, that they'll think through them and say, Lord, which one do I need to keep working on? And may your grace and your mercy be evident in their lives, we pray. Bless, Lord, as we go our separate ways, our fellowship, our study behind us, and for those that need to leave, journey mercies for them as well. We ask all this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, please. Amen. Hey, God's peace to you. Have a great week, church.